Excellent. Thank you, everyone. Good evening and welcome to everyone here at the Henry Jackson Society, and welcome to everyone joining us online. My name is James Spencer. I'm Director of Communications here at the HJS, and it's a real privilege to welcome you and our speakers this evening for our new report, from the Centre of Radicalisation and Terrorism, called Hindu-Muslim Civil Unrest in Leicester, Hindutva and the Creation of a False Narrative. We all saw the events which took place in Leicester in September and the debate that has arisen following it. The Henry Jackson Society, we believe it's only right that we shine a light on these events and we hold a lens up to what's going on in society so we can answer some of the really tough questions that are going on in our communities across the country. So joining me this evening is the report's author, Charlotte Letterwood. Charlotte is a PhD candidate in Arab and Islamic Studies at the University of Exeter, and her research focuses on Muslim minority conflict in the UK. I'm also joined by Ravi Vitani at far end. He is the national coordinator of Vikar Mantham, a platform dedicated to addressing the challenges facing British society through a sustainable and liberal lens. And also joining me just to my right here is Fayez Mungal, OBE, who began his career with the Citizens Advice Bureau in London and went to work as a lecturer for two different colleges in London and Oxford, and then was elected as city councillor at Oxford City Council and Haringey Council. So to start off, I think we'll be having just a general panel discussion. Then I will give opportunities for people in the room to ask some questions, and we'll also be taking questions online. So those watching online, there is a Q&A button. I recommend that you use that if you want to ask us a question. But first, let's go to Charlotte. Charlotte, can you just tell us some of the background to your report and some of the main findings and what we can do moving forward with the situation in Leicester?
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of those here with us in the room today and those joining us online may have first realised that there was something happening in Leicester over the weekend of the 17th, 18th of September. That was when it really came to the public consciousness. There was marching, protesting, and news started to descend on the city. But actually, what we realised when we visited Leicester, when we spoke to community members, when we spoke to Hindu community members and Muslim community members living specifically in the LE5 area of Leicester, we realised that this was an ongoing community cohesion breakdown that really had started a lot earlier in the year. And what became evident quite quickly was a community cohesion breakdown between predominantly Muslim and Hindu young males had been narrated as an infiltration of Hindutva extremism and RSS terrorism from the subcontinent, which had created a wider threat to the Hindu community across the country. And although there was definitely a religio prejudice between Muslim and Hindu young males in Leicester, there was not as yet, with the evidence to hand, RSS terrorism or an infiltration of Hindutva extremism organized groups in Leicester. And a little bit, if any of you are unaware of what I mean by RSS or Hindutva, I'm sure if you've been following this series of events, you've become quite familiar with what that is. But Hindutva has various different understandings, simply from Hinduness and expressions of Hinduness through to a extreme idea of Hindu supremacy that can harbour anti-Muslim sentiment. So the understanding of that term kind of differs from that simple understanding of Hinduness through to something that's more extreme. And RSS is described by some as a paramilitary male voluntary group in India that has links to violence, has been linked to anti-Muslim violence. But the extent to which that is present in the UK is very tenuous. It's not a prescribed terrorist organisation in the UK. And we call at the end of our briefing for further research into the area, but we did not find a risk of RSS terrorism or RSS terrorists in Leicester. So how did we come to this conclusion? We had to look at where the direct claims were being levelled. So there was a direct claim of a group of young Hindu men being RSS terrorists. So we made contact with that group of young men, and also actually later on Channel 4 made contact with them and interviewed them also. Our interviews were very similar to the Channel 4 interview, if you saw that one. And these young men had a very interesting story to tell. And I do think that their story is indicative really of what happened in Leicester. We found far more evidence to back this up, but their story in the time I have is the important story to tell. So these young men are from an area in Gujarat called, there's two areas, Diu and Daman in the northwest coast in the state of Gujarat. And these young men are from this area. They're part of a relatively new migratory group into the UK, quite often speaking Gujarati or Portuguese, some English language challenges there. And they tend to hold a lot of Hindu festivals. They're very outward projecting of their kind of their Hinduism. And they struggled to find themselves accepted in Leicester. They felt there was a lot of pushback against their festivals. There were complaints when we spoke to members of the Muslim community in the area, complaints of noise, festivals going on late into the night, alcoholism, antisocial behavior. And on the other side, speaking to members of this community, there was a sense, you know, these are our festivals, we should be allowed to have them. And this was the kind of bubbling tension that we were understanding there to be. And the kind of background of attacks between Muslim and Hindu youth with this religious prejudice going on. So we fast forward to the beginning of September, and these young men in question have their Hindu festival egged, and at least one has reported a stabbing, and the Channel 4 interview showed his wounds and discussed the stabbing incident with him. These are the young men that are being branded as RSS terrorists. And these are also, very interestingly, the young men that organized the Hindu march. So we were then able to see the flyer that they used to organize the Hindu march, which calls for a march in standing up and in solidarity for their ability to live safely and peacefully in Leicester and to not be cowed out of the area. They ask for two chants, Jai Shri Ram, and forgive me, I forget the name of the other chant, but it was about bringing peace and security. And their understanding and explanation for Jai Shri Ram was about a praise to their God. So we saw chants from both sides. We saw Takbir Allahu Akbar, we saw Jai Shri Ram. So we saw chants pertaining to God on both sides with these marches. We came to a conclusion with these young men that they had been falsely accused of RSS. They didn't know what it was. They actually kept calling it RRS. They couldn't even pronounce it properly. They had absolutely no understanding. They said that they had nothing to do with Modi and the BJP, and they'd been falsely accused, which it was replicated in the Channel 4 interview. So these young men falsely accused then face attack, stabbing, and what was an attack on the Hindu community for about 10 days in Leicester ahead of the marching. Attacks on cars with Hindu symbols, attacks on doors with Hindu symbols, a real agitation against the Hindu community relating to, I say again, the Hindu festivals, the noise, the antisocial behavior, and the clashing between this Muslim and Hindu youth that was happening from both sides. So the conclusion that we really draw before we move on to those that the nefarious actors that then came in and whipped up more hatred and more threat against the community. The conclusion we draw at this stage, so there is a religious prejudice between the youth. There is a micro community cohesion breakdown that needs to be addressed. Elements of territorial issues, elements about noise control and antisocial behavior that needs to be taken into consideration by the police and local authorities. But this is then falsely dressed up as RSS terrorism and Hindu for extremism and Hindu for extremist organizations active in Leicester. And this is where we see these, we describe them as influencers, and we discuss Majid Freeman and Mohammed Hijab in particular. essentially grabbing the microphone and running with this idea of Hindutva extremism and RSS terrorism. This is concerning because the individuals in question, one has reportedly given prayers to the brother of an ISIS fighter. One, Freeman has given prayers to the Taliban, and yet he is being picked up again and again and again by mainstream press, and eventually, most concerning of all, by the city mayor, who is helping to convene and set up the independent inquiry into what happened in Leicester. So we fast forward then into the end of September, where we've seen the press coverage of the issue, where we've seen who has been given the platform to speak. And the real concern, concluding concern of this report, is the level to which we indulged those who have expressed very concerning views that are against our British values, allowed them a platform that has brought risk and fear among the Hindu community, and left us in a situation where we don't trust the independence of the review that should be coming out at the end of this year. And that really is a summary of the journey, of the key pieces of evidence. It is much broader than that, but in the time that we have, that is a rapid summary. And I think we're now going to discuss kind of how the Hindu community are affected, and how that has been felt in Leicester, and about how we can build bridges. But that's it from me.
Thank you, Charlotte. Just going to pick up on some of the points you made about Hindutva. I think before September this year, that word was not part of the consciousness of British society. So I'm wondering, Ravi, if you could just give an talk us through what Hindutva actually means, and what it means also for like the lived experience of British Hindus.
Yeah. So I think it's important that we draw a split here between the narrative that was seen and the reality on the ground. So Hindutva is important on a narrative that we saw in social media and sort of mainstream media. But on the ground, we couldn't see any of it. It wasn't there. We didn't find any evidence of it. So that split is important. If you want to dive in and understand the term in itself, etymologically, it means Hindu, meaning Hindu, and Va, meaning ness. So Hindu-ness very literally is what it means. So any expression of your Hindu-ness, I could call Hindutva. So your Christianness, I could call Christianness, or Christian Tva, or Muslim Tva, or Islamic Tva, whatever that is. So that's how we could label it. Academically, it can be defined as, so S. Gurumurthy would put it as a kinetic aspect of Hindu culture. So when you express it, so when these local communities are doing their festivals on the street, that would be perceived as Hindu Tva, right? That they're expressing their Hinduness on the streets of Britain. And what was clear, and how that merged onto the reality and the narrative we saw, that was seen as not okay. And the language we saw on social media is, this is a Muslim area, and we're going to go on Muslim patrol because these people are expressing their Hindutva. It's not okay to express your Hindutva in a Muslim area in Britain, in liberal Britain, not okay. And this goes into the lived experience of what people, or the Hindu community and other minority communities actually in the area experience, which is that they got the message loud and clear that it's not okay to express your Hinduism. If you have any Hindu gods, any Hindu idols, any words on your door, on your car, it will be smashed. Now, it's very clear that a passive sticker on a car is not aggressive to anything. So if your car is being smashed for having that sticker, it's being smashed for expressing its Hinduism. Right? Your property is being damaged because you are expressing your Hinduism. So that much is extremely clear. The second bit that's clear, and we reference it in page 16, is that this narrative, this idea of Hindutva, is not new. That's a bit. Yeah. Somebody wants to listen to that. Is that better? Oops. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the second bit is that this narrative that came out in a very organized and clearly orchestrated manner was not grounded in Leicester. So in page 16, we see that this idea and this word Hindutva has been tried to be pushed by Muslim organizations for the past 18 months pre-Leicester. So it's a narrative they hit and said, okay, we're going to use this and build up hype around this, and we're going to use it whenever we get an opportunity to. And then what we saw in Leicester is then punching through this narrative on social media of Hindus are saying these people are extremists and therefore we're going to be violent against them. And if you want a specific example, there's a young man who was beaten, pretty graphic, and the justification on social media is he was Hindu, so we beat him. He's extreme, so it's okay if we're violent. It is essentially the justification that we're saying, and that's not okay at all. And he had no association. So it seems that there's this creation of a boogeyman that people can punch through, and that's creating a distraction from the real fact, from the real evidence, from the real sort of challenge to liberal and democratic values that we're seeing. And celebrating festivals, I mean, it's the equivalent of saying that, you know, if they celebrate Christmas on our street, that's an expression of Christianism, that's not okay. And that shutting that down shouldn't be okay in liberalism. We shouldn't have ghettoization that step back, not where we want it. And we saw this again, sort of, if we just briefly pick up on the speaker, that came up as a justification. So the speaker is visiting, mm-hmm. she's Hindu, she's inciting violence. There's some ideas that you can cling to in that, but realistically, that speaker is even last year and the year before and the year before that and the year before that and the year before that and the year before that, with no problems and no incitement and no violence. So again, it looks like it's a narrative that's been picked to justify action afterwards. So that's sort of Hindutva. The second bit, your second question was the experience of the Hindu community. And it lies in what they were experiencing. So for about 10 days, possibly even longer, but you think months, there had been Muslim patrols in that area, and there's social media references to Muslim patrol who were going around winding down their windows in that area saying, are you Hindu or Muslim? And if you don't reply in time or with the wrong answer, you get attacked, essentially. So this is their lived experience. When they went to the police, again, because of communication issues, they didn't feel listened to. They did not feel listened to. And eventually, on Saturday is when they went on this peace march. Post-event, what happened is when the mayor, for example, is talking and listening to Majid Freeman, before he talks to this community and saying, well, we know that Hindus are the problem and we should investigate it, then they feel like they're not going to be listened to. Because who are they going to go to? They can't go to the police and they can't go to the mayor, and the media is portraying them as RSS and Hindutva. Then who is it that they can go to? So their response to that is to go on a peace march. And I think we should be thankful that they went on a peace march and didn't do anything else. They're a disconnected community.
What was good to see in this, and Charlotte references some of the influences we saw, there were pockets of the Muslim community in Leicester that were trying to take the mic off, saying, you're not from here, please stop inviting, go home, we live together peacefully, we don't need this here. And I think that's a positive sign on the background of all this. But there is a responsibility for the mayor, for the media, to really portray the truth and have an independent voice. A classic example, there was a Guardian reporter interviewing people on the Sunday, and she was walking around with Majid Freeman next to her. And her report was, I felt threatened by the Hindutva. It must have been a granny walking down Burberry Street, but she's interviewing people with Majid Freeman. I would be interviewing Majid Freeman. I think there's a responsibility that comes with that of doing due diligence on who you give a platform to and who you listen to.
Thanks, Ravi. Now, you made a very interesting point about the mayor of Leicester and his review into the situation, what's going on. Fayaz, with your community's hat on, what can the mayor do to make the independent review actually independent? And what can he do to actually instill confidence in both communities in Leicester? That this review is actually going to get to the bottom of what is essentially a localized dispute between two groups of young men.
Fantastic. First of all, I hope the mic's picking me up. Is the mic picking me up? Because my voice is already dodgy as it is. So great. Let me grab this mic. Fantastic. So let me start off by saying that I've met Sir Peter Soulsby on occasion. I find him to be a very open, very kind-hearted individual. So we have a politician here who I think tries to do the right thing. However, and this is a however, in this instance, doing the right thing does not mean appointing one singular individual to head up a commission. A commission or an investigation into communities has to involve the communities themselves, or a completely independent individual, somebody like Baroness Casey. Right? Casey's just done a review with the Metropolitan Police, which the review has been damning around the practices of Metropolitan Police. But that's an independent review for you. That's somebody coming in who has got no skin in the game, who has got nothing on either side in terms of interest or connection to, but comes in and actually looks at the very facts on the ground. So if I had my way, I would suggest somebody like Baroness Casey to come in, or somebody of that ilk to come in and do an independent review. Because what we have here is a very serious issue around, I would say, issues of extremism and social cohesion that have kind of buttressed against themselves. And this report makes very clear, this report is crystal clear in the center ground it has taken on this issue, and has been crystal clear about the cohesion issue at this micro level that has been fermented into an international issue by some of the local actors who I think have been very mischievous in the way they've done this. So the first thing to say is we need somebody completely independent, somebody like Baroness Casey or other, to come in and do this review. Okay. The second thing I would also say, if you want to do an independent review, is to actively listen to those communities who are affected. And in this case, so I've been working up and down the country for about 20, 25 years with communities, lots of faith communities, Hindu communities, Muslim communities, Christian communities. And I've been in and out of Leicester. I can tell you, an issue of extremism has never been in Leicester. I've been in and out of our city. It's never been an issue of extremism, particularly RSS or Hindutva-related extremism. So we need to listen to what has happened to the community now. When I was up in Leicester on a separate project just last week, having just some conversations, and the feeling I get is that the Hindu community feel completely under, you know, in the trenches. They feel in the trenches after what's happened. And so any independent reviewer needs to give a sense of safety to these communities that they can come forward and discuss these issues with that independent person. And I think it's really important, because I think Sir Peter Salisbury has made an error in reacting so quickly and responding so quickly by placing one individual immediately into this frame. I think some due diligence in the sense of thought around who can be involved. Thought about a national impact, because this has a national impact. Thought about the actual independence of an individual needed to have been undertaken and done before somebody was appointed.
Thank you, Fayez. Right now, it gets to the point where we move to questions. I'm going to use Chairman's prerogative and ask the first question, but then happily take it to the room. What I'll do is I'll take questions in groups of three, and then we'll move on to answers. And then if you're watching online, please do use the Q&A button to ask questions. We have quite a few questions coming in. Many of them are asking roughly the same thing, so I'll try and paraphrase them so that most people get their questions answered. But firstly, my question is that what has happened, but it's now working out. What can we do to stop this happening again? And so what I'd really like the panel to talk about is how what was essentially a local dispute over noise has escalated into a microcosm of the relationship between India and Pakistan and the conflicts therein. And what can we do on a practical local level to improve the situation in terms of community cohesion, but also look at some of the things like noise pollution? As a councillor, I'm sure you know the difficulties of how local councils look at noise and monitor antisocial behaviour that way. So basically, over to the panel to ask, how can we practically put in place measures that will improve the situation? Charlotte, do you want to kick off?
Yes, okay. Do I need that one? I think this one's working. Okay, fabulous. I think I'm going to focus on a few things here, because Fayez, as founder of Faith Matters, will be brilliant to talk about community cohesion going forwards. But I think there were a number of key issues that were risen that, that we could do something about on a practical, maybe a less exciting area of discussion here. But things like encouraging English language, encouraging connection with understanding of how the police work, how the Citizens Advice Bureau works, how communities can make contact with their local authorities and seek help so that communities don't resort to conflict with each other and trying to resolve what essentially is noise disputes and thug behavior, territorial behavior between young males. How can we avoid that by going through the correct means of redress? So that's something I think Leicester really needs to think about quite urgently. And I think it's important that we don't use this as an opportunity to discuss politics in India and our dislike for politics and situation in India, and maybe our dislike potentially for Modi, if that is what the sentiment is. I don't think that is an opportunity to discuss that right now. I think we have a very sensitive, very hurt Hindu community in this country, and it's about focusing on repairing the trust we've damaged there. The press has damaged trust. Elected officials have damaged the trust. And what has been a mistake is this constant diversion. It's been quite easy for the press to do that. Let's just talk about the subcontinent. But that is not giving confidence to our Hindu community that we understand that they in Leicester are not attached, funded by, or a part of an organized arm of something in the subcontinent. And I think that's really important that we get that straight right away. There will be time, there will be space to discuss issues we have with politics in the subcontinent, but this is not the time. And I think that was quite an important lesson that I drew from this.
So, Fayez, and then...
So I think in Charlotte's report, which I suspect will be out later or tomorrow, it will be out online. I think this is an excellent report. And I think there's one word that jumped out when I was given a draft brief to look at it, just to look at what the report was saying. And that one word that jumped out was the projection. This word projection was used in one of the sentences I read, and it's a brilliant word. Why do I think this is a brilliant word, and why am I introducing this now? Because actually what we have in this whole issue is a... No problem. What I mean by projection is this whole essence of fears, projected fears by local activists around the India-Pakistan situation and the Indian subcontinent issues around politics. They projected their fears right into this conflict. They projected them. So they've had the fears around what's happening in India, and they've literally vomited it into this scenario, which is a local cohesion issue. That is what Charlotte's report says, and it is bang on. Now, let me go back to the issues about what can be done around social cohesion. Well, Charlotte's report makes very clear this is an integration issue. It's a localized integration issue. What does that mean? What is the word? What do these buzzwords mean? Well, integration means making these people, that community that you mentioned from that certain specific location in Gujarat, feel that they have an opportunity to engage with the local authority. People who have a noise issue should be raising these issues in ward area committees at a local council level. There are open ward area meetings where local councillors, who should be doing their job, should be having these open discussions around noise, refuse, pollution, all these local issues. They should be having these discussions with their local residents. My question is, where are the councillors in this? Why are these issues not being raised? Is there an issue around engagement of the local authority with local communities? Why are officers not doing that? That's the second question. And the other issue is, I think also, we also have the opportunity within local authorities for scrutiny meetings. These are open platform meetings with local councillors in appointed boards where people can go and raise an issue. Why are they not being used? So the question I have with Leicester City Council is, where are these meetings and why are they not reaching out to these kind of communities, the ones who have noise issues, to this very community that doesn't feel included in Leicester, that wants to express itself religiously and has every right to express itself religiously? Why is this engagement not taking place? I'll also add on two other layers and then I'll stop. I know I can go on forever. People know me very well for that. But actually around police engagement, why is it police are engaging when this has gone wrong? Whereas the police engagement of the local bobby speaking to local areas is really important. I understand there are resourcing issues. Well, what happened to our police officers having a conversation and saying, you've got a problem? Maybe I can bring my sergeant to come and have a chat with you. Because police engagement and police fora are an absolutely key conduit to bring up these issues, not just localized issues, but if there are interlopers coming in to foment extremism and vomit their projections into issues, the police, it's not policing matter, but police should be saying to local authority, look, you have some issues here. The connection between police and local authority is fundamental. It's fundamental. Where is that? And the last thing I would say around the press, because I think we've talked about the lack of due diligence by local politicians, but I want to say about the press, where was the due diligence or the lack of due diligence within the press? They were turning up with agitators in Leicester. I mean, if the press want to be taken seriously, a simple Google check would have shown up question marks about the activity and the narratives of some individuals. What the heck when a Google check was not carried out and they turned up on the ground? That's dangerous. It's dangerous, not just for Leicester. It's dangerous for any part of our country. What if a member of a far-right extremist group turns up and the press goes, here we go, here's a microphone. Where's the due diligence in checking who you're engaging with? Right, who's with you? So I think there are some questions for the police. There are some questions for local authority leaders, for councillors, and for local council officers in relation to how do they move forward to enmeshing a strategy which brings these individuals and brings these issues to the forefront.
Thank you.
I concur with a lot of what's been said already. I think I'll add two key points. And Fayaz and I were talking about this earlier, that blaming India and blaming this Hindutva narrative is a really easy cop-out. But what it does is it distracts us from the reality. And the reality is that there's a pattern. And there's a pattern of the same individuals and the same institutions using the same playbook from different parts of Britain to make it less liberal. And that's not okay. We have to start there. We have to examine this ecosystem. How are they so structured? How are they so organized? Who's running this? Why do you repeatedly, time and again, in North London and Birmingham and Leicester, many of the times over the past 20 years, give these people a platform? What's going on in our liberal society that we're giving illiberal people a platform? That, number one. Number two is, again, we can isolate Leicester, but the secondary question comes is that, okay, but these people were able to incite. And there was an ecosystem in the petri dish that was conducive to being incited, right? It doesn't make any sense. If you look at social media and you have the same tropes going on, pagan, cow fisting, reincarnation jokes, something is being taught to a wider community that's saying, hey, these people, right? And that formed a really nice base to then recruit from. That's what it does. And you can say it in India, but you're going to ignore the point that some of this is homegrown. Right, and that's a really nice petri dish. It's very easy for these people to go and be saying,
yeah,
look, your Muslim brothers are being attacked, come and help. And these youth, they got a sense of purpose, thought they're doing the right thing. We're beating the pagans. And the narrative that we saw, and it was very quickly turned into theology of, it was turned into a battle between the heart and the body, which is the angels and you're fighting the devil. You're the angels and you're fighting the devil. And as a young person in England, you're going to resonate with that. You're going to go, great, I can feel good and I can go and beat up some people and cause some mischief and I'm doing the right thing. And therefore, what also needs to be scrutinized is what is being taught to these people, right? To the kids that were turning up. But they're not immensely sophisticated. I mean, we were there, we were talking to them. They're not sophisticated, but they believe some of this stuff. So the question is, where is this being taught? Who's teaching it? Should it be scrutinized? And the third bit is also to then do a follow-up. So one of the things we picked up is that this narrative that was constructed was used to mask something. And it seems like what it was used to mask is the targeting and this idea that this is a Muslim area and Hindus shouldn't be here. And they're driving out in the land. We saw that Hindu houses had been attacked. We didn't see Muslim houses being attacked. If there was evidence, we'll find it. So then there also needs to be a long-term follow-up. It's not a sudden issue. It's okay. Well, did it work? Despite all of what's happening now and this being uncovered, are Hindu families being driven out of that area. And if that's happening in modern Britain, where a certain community is being driven out of certain areas, what's to stop that happening elsewhere with other communities? So there needs to be long-term follow-up.
Right, we'll go to questions in the room. So if you can keep your questions brief, please, and avoiding making grand statements. I'll take three questions at a time. So if you go to the three gentlemen at the back, please. Oh, if you wait for the microphone gets you, so people online can hear you. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm from the LE5A myself. Actually witnessed quite a few of the events that's happened. Every single point you lot made is really good. I think you're on point in some respect of what you discussed today. What I want to know is, what does justice look like for us? For our Hindu community, what does justice look like? Because that's what we're interested in.
Yeah.
Not interested in intimidation or responding back in a negative way. Just what is justice for us?
Thank you. Gentleman in the turban at the back.
Hello, thank you for publishing this report. You mentioned earlier that we shouldn't look at the politics of this that has been projected, as you say, on the communities in Leicester and other parts of our country. But do you not think that perhaps there is a very significant link with the politics of the Indian subcontinent, particularly the more recent phenomena we've seen of Sartan Se Juda, which basically has led to a beheading of a Hindu tailor in Rajasthan a few months ago, where you had Islamic extremists using that phrase openly, calling for people to be beheaded? Do you not think that perhaps the former Prime Minister of Pakistan, with his tirades in his tweets, calling India a fascist state, calling Modi a fascist, elected again, mind you, by the biggest mandate in history, respected across the Islamic world, from the UAE to the Saudis, to the Saudis, do you not think that perhaps there is a possibility that these nefarious designs by the Pakistani deep establishment, the deep state in Pakistan, has had a role to play in this?
Thank you. And final question at the back, please.
Yeah, I just wanted to concentrate on two aspects, which I think probably do get lost in. Firstly, with regards to basic failings of organisations, for example, the police. The analogy I drew at the time was, if that was a rival football faction protesting outside a football ground, there would have been preemptive action, intelligent, it would have stopped it. Well, if that's something that can be done on a weekly basis, it is for 38 weekends of the season, why on earth was it not preempted in a tinderpot atmosphere where you knew there was essentially issues with community cohesion? A couple of you spoke about the media, and I think the media do need to take a lot of the blame, not just the due diligence aspect, but even the words. If you examine them closely, when we use the term Islamism now, it's almost euphemistic, because let's be honest, it's this fundamental Islamic whatever you want. But I saw a lot of articles which twin that and almost juxtapose it by saying hardline Hindu fascist. Well, let's be honest, in layman's speeches, you use the term, a euphemism essentially, as Islamism, and then you juxtapose it with hardline Hindu fascist. Most lay people are going to go to the hardline Hindu fascist because it resonates with the 1940s and thereafter. And that's the thing. So both organizers and others, they need to be held accountable to some degree. It's difficult to see how and where, but it'd be interesting to see how you guys think that would be possible to do and how effective it would be.
Thanks. Charlotte, if you start with that first question, then Fires, if you can pick up on the gentleman's question about the India-Pakistan relationship, and then Ravi, if you can go about what justice looks like, that'd be great. So, Charlotte.
James, would it be all right to talk a little bit about the Pakistan question?
Yes, but I'm conscious we've got lots of people online with questions.
I do very quickly just want to say about the question about whether we discuss this through the lens of whether there should be an opportunity to talk about politics in the subcontinent. I was specifically referring to how this was made about Hindutva and Modi infiltration into the UK. We had no verifiable evidence that that was taking place. And where there were direct claims of that taking place, we found that to be false, which is why I think it's important to not use this as an opportunity to talk about that area of the politics. However, you will find when you read the report that we do have evidence that one of the key instigators of the anti-Hindutva Muslim marches
did have links to extremism in Pakistan. So that I didn't talk about that in our discussion here, but obviously with that evidence being there, then there is an importance to talk about it from that angle. But I'm talking about making the emphasis about Hindutva and Modi when we haven't found evidence of that, and that's unfair. What is justice? This is a tough one because a lot of the injustice has been in the way the press has handled this. And the unfortunate thing with the press is it, if they've painted someone in a wrong fashion, all you can hope for is an apology weeks later somewhere in an article saying they apologize for something that they said weeks earlier. And I know that this is going to be really hard for the Hindu community and in Leicester. It makes me sad to talk about what does justice look like, because it's going to be very difficult to heal these wounds and the way that the media has treated the community, the way politicians have treated the community. But justice will, hopefully, we will move towards justice when we see an independent review put in place. Hopefully we'll move towards independence when we see police reaching out to the communities, local authorities reaching out to the communities, and when we see some kind of addressing of engaging with the agitators and how that's made the Hindu community feel. But it's going to be a long process, and it's not going to be, there won't be a quick answer for this.
I don't know anything about the Pakistan deep state, and I'd assume you mean kind of the intelligence services by deep state possibly, but I'm not going to comment on that because that's just conjecture. What I will say is that the rhetoric in India and Pakistan needs to calm down, right? Everyone needs to take a step back, because there are implications where we have agitators here who try to manipulate the politics of what happens internationally and bring it in here. That's what this evidence is showing. That actually, to be honest with you, we all get on. We do get on, and we have local community cohesion issues. This is not a unique issue around Leicester. Community cohesion issues happened in Bradford 15, 20 years ago. They happened in Tottenham. Well, I used to live in Tottenham. I saw Broadwater Farm go up in 1985. That's how old I am. We've had community cohesion issues before, but we've never had a wholesale take up of extremism and then dropped in as a narrative into a local community cohesion issue. So in a way, what I'm saying is there are local actors, and they could possibly be international actors fermenting and agitating for turmoil in our local communities. And that means we have to redouble our efforts to find who are instigating these issues, to find if anyone's funding the instigation of these issues, and to call these instigators out. We have a public duty. You have a duty. I have a duty. We on this board, Charlotte's done a significant amount of work in her public duty that she's placed here, saying we need to speak out to find out who the agitators of this local community cohesion issue is. Just the last sentence, if I can, Ravi, please forgive me for picking up on your question, on what your response to the question would be. But as a member of a Muslim, British Muslim community, I want to say one thing. What does justice for the Hindu community look like? For me, I'd say acknowledgement of the pain. Acknowledgement by the authorities in Leicester and others of the pain that and distress this is caused the Hindu community. Because it's not the Hindu community I see that has been labeled as a Hindutva. The Hindu community I see has been a very peaceful, law-abiding, getting on with things, wanting to practice their religion, which they have every right to do. But I think an acknowledgement of the deep pain this has caused is a starting point. I'd like politicians to start to say that. We acknowledge your pain. Mm-hmm. Now we need to act on it.
I think I'll say a few things, which is, what was being shut down was Hinduism, an expression of Hinduism. And if an expression of Hinduism is being liberal and being festive and celebrating knowledge, then this is something that we should encourage in England, first of all. The second bit is that our interactions with the police in Leicester, they weren't ready for it. They were not ready for it. They should have been proactive. And if we want to give them some slack, it was Queen's funeral. Right, but in fairness, on Sunday they did respond, and they were pretty good on the Sunday. So Sunday was thankfully relatively peaceful. But it seems like they're woefully ill prepared for this, essentially, and they have trouble. When we were speaking to the police officers, so one of one of the German committee members was attacked. They were saying, we're struggling to prosecute the perpetrators of this violence because nobody wants to talk. Can't do it with no evidence. So in order for people to come forward, there has to be the feeling of safety. I will be safe, right? I won't be prosecuted or targeted on social media. The first and foremost is for the police and the authorities to provide feeling of safety to the community. You can talk and we will listen. And that's not going to happen if the mayor is doing what he's doing and there isn't an independent review and the media are doing what they're doing. It's not going to happen. You're not going to create an environment of safety, first of all. The second bit is the scrutiny, as you said, of these perpetrators, but again, of what's being taught and where this ideology is coming from. And the third bit is to promote those voices that are liberal and giving them a platform, very specifically in the Muslim community, because they are there in Leicester. We've spoken to them in Leicester, and they're immensely frustrated. They're like, these are our neighbors, we know them, we celebrate Diwali with them, and they come over for Eid, and some of our other Muslim brothers are going and attacking them. We don't want it. And they haven't been given a voice. So that I think is important, giving them a voice. In terms of wider context, what this sort of overarching narrative was used as a distraction, I think in the West it's important we do understand what's going on in India and Pakistan and what these countries are doing and how that politics may or may not impact us here. So Vijayanand has been looking at Hindutva, we're going to produce a brief in the next couple of months. It's important we understand it for two reasons. One is so it can't be misconstrued and picked up and used as a false narrative. And the other bit is that it is going to impact. It is going to impact. And Britain has to understand which of these spaces is more liberal and allow more freedom of thought and is going to be more conducive to British values. So we can't just disengage with it and say this is not a problem, because it very realistically is. And justice, I think, is going to be is scrutiny, independent report, and persecution, prosecution, correct prosecution of those perpetrators that have broken the law.
Thank you. Right, going online now. Now we've had quite a few questions come in. So what I've done is I am amalgamating them into two questions which encompass quite a few of the questions have been asked. Many questions have come in about Islamophobia within the Hindu community. Can we talk a bit about what examples that we have found about that? And then maybe a wider discussion, which represents more of questions coming in, that situations like this, if we don't treat them properly and impartially, could it exacerbate, could it run the risk of creating more Islamophobia within the Hindu community if we don't get on top of it? And then the second question really is taking religion out of it and seeing these the perpetrators as young men, going into sort of the question about gang culture. Is there a wider societal issue here, which is encouraging these young men to go out and act in this certain way? And what can we do to tackle that? So, I don't know, Quias, if you want to kick off on that.
Yeah. So let me come on to the issue of looking at these issues impartially, as this report does. This report, I think, balances the impartiality element perfectly, as strongly as possible. Okay. The reason is, and I think this issue about impartiality is so important, as you have rightly said, because these are highly fragmentary issues, they are divisive issues, they are inflammatory issues. And unless we don't look at it in the cold, at the facts, in the cold light of day, any cycle of these kind of narratives can be reinforced. Right? So if we move in the wrong direction and move into conjecture and not look at the facts and what the facts are showing us and the interviews with people are telling us, as they do in this report, then we could fuel one side or the other, and this becomes a long-term problem. Instead of a short to medium-term issue that we can manage and work through, it then becomes a longer-term divisive issue where other actors, remember the Sikh gentleman in the back said about international actors, where international actors can come into play in a much more stronger way. Mm. So in a way, we have to look at the cold clinical facts, and the report lays this out. Because conjecture can really fragment Leicester for a very long period of time with highly inflammatory issues. Now, Can I just pick up on the gang culture issue? Because I think there is something there. There is something really relevant there that the questioner has raised online. Because I think as part of this whole issue, the response we saw in the kind of gang type related response wasn't a response of, well, there's two responses. One of 200 young men, mainly of Muslim heritage and background or Muslim faith, turning up outside a mandir. It's 200. So there is something around identity in a group pack that shows itself there. In other words, there is a gang type mentality in group packing that turned up to intimidate a mandir, which is awful. In a way, what I'm pointing to on the practical face-to-face gang type incident we saw and the online gang up we've seen is an issue of identity, where young men are choosing to jump into an issue of identity by choosing them and us. You understand me? Not identity that I'm comfortable in who I am, not identity that actually I'm happy or comfortable with eating, sharing, being friends with my British member of the British Hindu community. That is a strong identity around connection. This identity was fragmented. This identity was them and us. This identity was aggressive and overwhelmingly male. Can you see what I'm saying? Is that this is a problem around men and their perception of who they are. And who they are can easily be triggered because of the vacuousness by conflict. And I guess what I'm pointing back to is a failure of work around integration and identity. And I put that failure back to local politicians who don't have a strategy to say what Leicester stands for. They'll talk about Leicester stands for tolerance. We're all tolerant. Well, there's an example of lack of tolerance. It doesn't wash anymore. What does Leicester stand for? What do we in Leicester stand for is a piece of work that needs to be done. But I go back further. That progressive governments over the last 5 years have no integration strategy properly developed in this government. All right, I'm going to be a critic now because I've worked with successive governments on integration strategies. Some have been very good, but after 2015-16, there has been no integration strategy properly put into place by governments. And there is a gaping hole around what integration means to us as a nation. And so there are two gaps that need filling in this process. But I just want to say that I think there is a gang type culture which is based on them and us because of a vacuousness of who these young men are.
Ravi.
I'll pick up on Islamophobia first. And I think it's an interesting idea and how we define it really matters. So Rumi Hassan in his IEA report kind of alluded to the idea that if it's used too broadly as a blanket term, which we think it is, then it can kind of mitigate critique and I think the word we use was scrutiny. And then it mitigates any sort of engagement. And that doesn't help integration. So we have to be careful how we define it. And if we define it, then it should be used to help integration, people should feel safe. And on the other side, the question is then, what about Hindu hatred and Hindophobia in the UK? And should we look at doing research and defining statistics into this space? And that is important. The one that I'll underpin this with is that what's important here is to understand the mindset. And if the mindset is that we as a community are being attacked, whether it's in the Muslim community or the Hindu community, then that community is going to feel isolated. So if there is a victim mentality, that community is going to be isolated.
So building a mentality that is a non-victim mentality, where people like they are British, they can integrate the British infrastructure, the institutions will listen to them, and they feel British. My British identity comes first, and then it's my Hindu identity. Or my British identity comes first, and then it's my Muslim identity. Then we have integration. And until we have that, if I'm a Muslim first and then I'm British, guess which one's going to come first in this gang culture? So that's very clear. And Islamophobia can just fight the issue, so we should be very, very clear on that. And just to pick up on this idea of tolerance, that yes, but this definition of tolerance has been used to say we should allow everything. The things we shouldn't allow is intolerance. But then that has to be questioned. If it's being taught in schools or madrasas or masjids, we should know, and it should be questioned.
I do think it's important just to make sure, as you haven't been able to read the report yet, we highlight very early on that there was anti-Muslim hate and anti-Hindu hate on the ground in Leicester on both sides. There was an attack that has been reported to the police is under investigation. So that's the level of evidence we have at this stage, on May 22nd, in which a Muslim young man was attacked by a group of Hindu young men. And these similar attacks were happening in reverse. And the theme was asking, are you Hindu or are you Muslim? If they were Hindu, they were attacked by a group of Muslim men. If they were Muslim, and vice versa. Sorry. So there really is an issue of religious prejudice on the grassroots in Leicester. The question was whether this is part of organized extremism, terrorist groups, and infiltration from abroad. That was the real question that we had to unpick and answer, because the painting of it with this false narrative is what created the threat against the Hindu community across the country. And that's where a very grave mistake was made by politicians and the press. But it would be wrong to not highlight that there really is an issue on the community-based level here. I wonder if the gang culture question maybe was more particular to the fighting between the young Muslim and the young Hindu men. And if that is what the question was pointed towards, I think we've got an issue there of... it will be employment issues, economic issues, integration issues, trust in police. There was a real sense of young men on street corners intimidating one another. There was a real sense of territory. And that was particularly from the young Muslim side towards the young Hindu side, but sort of this is not your area. And so that's what I saw on the sort of gang side, but I would say gang, understanding gang is not necessarily my area of expertise, but that's what we saw there.
Thank you. Well, we did start a little late, so I think we have time for two more very quick questions, if I can hit from the audience. Gentlemen in the front row.
Thank you very much.
Do you wait for the microphone? Thank you.
Right, thank you very much.
With a lot of interest as a Muslim from the West Midlands. How much of this do you believe is because of the failings of integration, cohesion? Because I had an experience of living in Leicester 3 decades ago. And on the university campuses, this already existed. Groups of Indians, groups of Muslims, Pakistanis or whatever. It was a daily thing. You live it. How much of what happened now is just a result of that vacuum existing 3 decades.
Thank you. And gentleman behind the grey jumper.
Just two quick questions here, and touching upon the sort of external influences. This seems to be a much more bigger and wider international strategic effort, because just recently in the US, in New Jersey, the Democratic Party listed various past rule and named a few organizations as extremist organizations, and there's similar named organizations in this country as well. So is there something much more broader and international and strategic going on here about this whole Hindutva narrative, etc.? And who are those people and why, I think, needs to be investigated in detail. And just finally, these influencers and instigators, what is the government, the police and social media organizations doing about these people, because they're still being given a free rein?
Charlotte, if you pick up on the influencers, then we go to think Ravi and Fires around the gentleman's question here about the wide historical nature of it.
I think the difficulty is with the influencers. The influencers tread a fine line and are very clever about making sure they don't verifiably break the law. One of the noted influencers in the report is Anjum Chowdhury, who was someone who did break the law as Section 12 of the Terrorism Act and served, I think, 5 or 6 years and is now free. And the embargo on him being able to speak was lifted, I think, about a year ago. And so he chose, with his freedom of voice once again, to get involved in a community issue and talk about converting Hindus to Islam. So I think that the police and the law does try and deal with these agitators, but it is a fine line between freedom of speech in this country and what we can do within the law. That's not to say that these individuals are not understood, you know, by the likes of ourselves in think tanks. I'm a former Prevent and Counter Extremism coordinator myself, so issues of extremism and issues of hate and community cohesion breakdown, we are aware of those that are agitators, and work around that is an ongoing process. But we don't have to bear in mind our laws around freedom of speech and our values of freedom of speech, and then that is the balance and the line that we tread, and it is a difficult one.
I'll start with the question of integration, and I think it's a very complex challenge. When you have organizations that are openly stating on their websites that our singular aim is to use democratic means to turn to implement Sharia law in Britain, they're not looking for integration. So then how do you approach that, and how do you deal with that? And they're not breaking the law, they're extremely welcome. So how do you deal with that? I think Priya's point to something, which is a level of due diligence on the background of individuals that we are appointing to reviewers or committees or who the government is engaging with. And that's important, because if people are stirring hatred, then institutions in Britain should stop engaging and not providing them a platform. And that, in effect, is saying that we won't tolerate intolerance. Right? I'm not saying you should no platform everyone. I'm saying if there's a proven track record, then there needs to be a level of intolerance. And the third idea is the provision of the safe space to allow ideas to be critiqued. You should be able to critique anything. You provide a factual evidence base, but every idea should be able to critique. And any shutting down of that is illiberal and fundamentally not British. It doesn't stand up to British values. So I think building out education systems in schools and universities that allow kids to do that and allow us as a society to openly question these ideas, it's fundamental. It's a long road, but it's fundamental.
Thanks. And finally, Pius.
Yeah, I think in response to your question, I think there is a vacuum of cohesion. We know that. It's been going on for a long, long time. And I think successive governments have tried to put resource into this and done some really good, credible work. But the problem we have is, like any democratic society, the next government comes along and throws out the baby with the bathwater and then starts from scratch, kind of level one. The problem is that we've not had any work done on a cohesion strategy for, I'm saying, 6 to 7 years now. This country has no cohesion strategy, which is a well-developed strategy for 6 to 7 years. Can you believe it? And yet we are a very diverse country. How does that marry up? It doesn't marry up. The question should be to the government, why have you not developed a cohesion strategy? Where is the cohesion strategy? Why is the cohesion strategy not sitting with an extremism strategy? They are different, but there are points of confluence, like this issue has shown. And I think the second thing we should also say, if the national government doesn't want to do cohesion for whatever reason, God knows, I can't speak for them, then local authorities need to focus on this area. And I understand that resources have been pulled out from cohesion. A lot of the cohesion officers have gone. They're not funded anymore, right? There's no money in cohesion to do this kind of work. But local authorities have got to find a way to put some resource into this area, because look what happens when you don't put resource. There is not only a social impact, there's an economic impact to your city, and there is a reputational impact on your city. You know, I can tell you successive UK governments have sold British cities as something as a gleaming symbol of how we all get on. They've done that. They go over to different countries and they say, look how we deal with things. Look at how we do it. And that's been great work. But how can you do that when we have some issues right on the ground in some of our local cities today, which shows you that the fabric of our society needs investment and work. Otherwise, over time, it starts to pull away. Like anything, you need to keep the focus on these areas. And it starts to pull away, not because we live in an island, because we don't. However much politicians think we live in an island, we are every day influenced by communication, every day influenced by international politics. We are every day influenced by things that affect the way we think. And if we don't have those local cohesion or cohesive elements of empathy towards each other, understanding local structures, as has just been said, Ravi said, knowing your rights. If those component bits are not in place, then the bits that pull us apart are going to tear us apart pretty quickly. Okay, so my call is at a local and a national level, cohesion comes back on the agenda. It's not a wokey thing. Let me just make that very clear, right? Because I'm fed up with this wokey thing that goes on. It's a substantive thing that needs to be done for our collective safety and security.
Thank you. As we can see, this is a really important issue. It's an important issue for our communities, for our country. And even though discussions like this can be uncomfortable, these discussions, regardless, we need to have. So can I thank the members of our panel for their enlightening debate? Can I thank all those people who have asked questions as well? And can I thank everyone in the audience, both here in the building and online,